Yo, this I'm loving this conversation. Okay, let's talk about another transition. Does Marek transition with you guys to now this next album?
No, so from that, from the African Source album, we went to Live and Die in Africa. Sorry, from the African Source album, yeah, we went to Midnight Train.
Yep.
And Midnight Train now is when we signed to Universal. So
let's talk about even getting that deal. How did that happen?
Signing with Universal took 3 years, like back and forth. We felt like we were getting a raw deal.
So they approached you while they were approaching Eastern Africa, the Diamonds.
Yeah, when they were approaching everybody. I remember Diamond signed a deal at that time. We didn't sign because we didn't think the money was good. And eventually they came and the deal was doable.
Mm-hmm. And what did this deal mean? What does it mean when they approach you with a deal?
For me, it meant like we were going global. Already at the time, I felt like we had really hit a ceiling here in Kenya.
Mm.
And with the stuff we're doing with Marek, you know, you remember Marek, we were his first artist to ever manage.
Mm.
He's a brilliant guy, but we needed like a higher power, so to speak.
Yeah.
So we moved our management to ACA, Africa Creative Agency, ACA.
Mm.
And a gentleman called Colin Gill took over from Marek. Colin Gill is
based in South Africa.
Yeah, based in Joburg. And he's our manager to date now.
So now you move your ACA.
Yeah.
So now you move your management to him.
Yeah.
So basically all shows you if even a SAFCOM is calling you, or did you also have management in Kenya?
So for now, like, I have a team here in Kenya that handles my business in Kenya. And then Colin handles our international business, which is now in COVID when there's not much happening, like our deals with YouTube, our deals with our music being used for synchronizations in movies.
Yeah.
The publishing end of our stuff. And we are making plans also, like, I think we should be touring Europe in the summer this year.
Yeah, but even before we get there, I know you guys then, by the time you're signing this deal, there's no COVID. Mm. By the time you got the deal with Universal, by the time you recorded
no
the
COVID
album. So by the time
we had made plans, you guys, we were going to go all over the world, like, pushing the album. Like, I had really
you already
seen
had
the promised land from afar. We already had the bookings. You know, like, so also with growth, some things come as an artist. As an artist, you shouldn't be waiting for the phone to ring and then you go do a show. Because then you're giving too much power to all the variables around you. You create your own table to eat. So with all the times we invested money doing our tours in America and Europe on our own, paid off, we signed with a tour company that now was giving us 25 shows in the States, I think, and 20 shows in Europe. So there we had like 45 shows. Like, those are sealed, signed, you know.
And this is, we're not talking about going to perform for Kenyans. We're talking about going
Now this is global, man. This is like, you know, this is Rock Nation. The company that was signing with us is a subsidiary company of Rock Nation.
Yo.
Yeah. So they're also doing Burna Boy's tour. You know, you see all of Burna Boy's dates.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you know what happens is, when you look at an artist touring and you see the place is full, his fans who came here because of him maybe are like 70%.
Mm-hmm.
The other 30 are people who are coming to discover.
Mm.
In first world countries, guys go to discover new talent like that. So a guy is watching Sauti Sol for the first time. They were sent for an email. They Googled you. Oh, this is a nice night to go watch music, you know.
That's crazy.
And
okay.
People are going to discover, like, already in Europe we're selling out now at that point. So, like, even when our tour was announced, like, our show, like, in that tour when you announced it, our show in London sold out 2 nights.
What?
At the Jazz Cafe in London, yeah, it was already sold out.
And we're talking about how many people at the Jazz Cafe?
Jazz Cafe is it's not a big venue, it's a legendary venue.
Uh-huh, yes, I get what you mean.
So Jill Scott was broken in the Jazz Cafe.
Yo.
And, like, Craig David broke in the Jazz, like, a lot of very big musicians broke in the Jazz Cafe.
Mm.
When you come, when you're talking about venues, it's not about the size.
Yes, it's
about it's also about the kind of people who go there.
Yep.
Now. So the
in
first
fact, there's
night,
some venues you can't even enter no matter how big you
are.
Yeah,
you can't even get a night in that spot.
Mm.
You know, and it's a cafe. But you know Dave Chappelle is going to walk in and sit down. You know when Blinky Bill told us he was performing and Dave Chappelle came and sat down?
Yeah.
Those things happen in venues like those ones, like the Jazz Cafe. So like, on our shows, without any help, we're doing already 1,000 capacity venues. And we're doing like, I don't know how many shows. So now with this one, we're going to do maybe the same 2,000, maybe 1,200, 1,500, but now a whole circuit.
Ooh.
And now you work the circuit over and over with your album until something happens, you know, like that's where your break comes from.
That's crazy. So Universal, the deal now that you signed with Universal was going to even open up more doors globally. Yes. They were going to finance this album if you wanted.
Yeah, they did. They financed the, like, the creation of the album.
Yo. Yeah. So they're like, here's upfront money. That means it opens up their relationships, their studios that they have.
Yeah,
globally.
Man, the studios, we recorded in Joburg. We recorded in LA. We lived in Hollywood for a minute there for like a month. We stayed in Joburg for like 3 months. And you know, when you're in this environment now, you meet now people who are in the business, and people are working, man. You know, like one of our producers, Andre Harris, who did Midnight Train, Sober, and Time Flies with Burna Boy.
Sober is my best song, by the way, of Midnight Train, and we'll come talk about that one.
Yeah. And Andre Harris has been around since the 2000s, man, and he's just been, he's worked with Michael Jackson all the way to now working with Sauti Sol and Burna Boy and Wizkid. Like, he's always been on the pulse. He's in his 40s, but he's never stopped working, and he has royalties for days. You can only imagine. This guy, I'm hanging out with him, he's playing for me Michael Jackson's vocals, not a TV.
He's
been for me raw vocals, and him talking like, yeah, I want to add some money. He's like, he has all of that. When you're working with Michael Jackson, you record everything, he says. So, like, it's beautiful to see those things and understand that these things are within my reach. Even me, I can have them. You know, and when you're recording Midnight Train, you're also recording now with the mindset that this has to be a global.
Yep.
So this whole message.
So, okay, in fact, you see, as you've talked about the different albums, I can see the transition where, okay, now we're doing acoustic, now we want pop. Now I can even feel the feel of we want Africans.
But Midnight Train completely was Sauti Sol in a Mwanzo mindset. Not trying to impress anybody, just writing songs that make us happy.
I love that.
Again,
one.
You know, no pressure from anybody to make a hit. You know, we've also just grown up, we've become better at what we do. So the byproduct of that is just a good album.
At this time, you are engaged or married, or so even you're dating for long.
Dating, was it now is Ugo. Me and my wife have been together now 6 years, bro. Dating is from 2015 till now.
I get. So by the time you're making this, you're even in a settled mentality.
Yeah.
But are you also thinking about the audience?
I don't think I've ever been settled, though, in my head. Like, when people think that you get married, then you settle down. Settle down, yeah, you stop, like, sleeping around and shit. But settle down mentally? I've never settled. Like, I'm always thinking of what next. You know, as being a musician is thinking for the future of your audience and what they need to hear. And how you're going to increase, like, their taste buds, you know.
In fact, but what I like what you're talking about, you're in a different mind frame.
Completely, yeah.
Yeah. So what mind frame were you in, were you guys at when you are working on this album, and what was...
It was just trying to create something that's honest. All the stories in that album are things that are happening to us or people around us. And it's just being honest, like...
Okay, I like it. Yeah. Honesty explains it.
Exactly.
So you guys are working on this album, and I think maybe you're in mixing stage or something, and then bang, COVID.
Not mixing stage.
Yeah.
We'd already finished recording everything. We'd already... Last year, we met in the arena, an airport in Atlanta, on our way to New Orleans. Not last year, wait, 2019.
Yeah.
2018 even.
2018.
Going to New Orleans to play Essence Festival. We met in the arena at the airport. Patricia Kihoro, I was with Patricia Kihoro and Chimano. I told them, oh, my jama, who's in India? I'm just seeing a goddess walking. I'm like, who's in India? Who are you? And if anybody who knows me, I'm an India junkie. Like,
yeah.
I have all her albums. I listen to all her music, all that. Like, she's my compass. She's my Bible in music. And Maze, I walked up to her and I was like, yo, my name is Bien, I'm from Kenya. Are you in India? She was like, yeah. And we just, like, hit it off, started talking. Patricia came there and Chimano, we had a fun moment. We found out, she was just like, who are these guys? They're from Kenya, okay. And we switched Instagram accounts.
Listen, me, I'm a musician, check us out.
Yeah, then she checked us out. So by the time I was getting, she asked her, where are you going? She was like, I'm going to my mom's house. It was so real for her to say, yeah, it's Thanksgiving, I'm going to my mom's, it's Memorial Weekend, something like that. And I'm going to my mom's house, I was like, oh, that's beautiful. Then when we go to the other, our flight was like a 2-hour flight. When we go to the other side, we checked, opened our Instagram. She responded, yo guys, it was nice meeting you today, blah, blah, blah. And I was like, I've made it. I think I just need to quit now.
Kufika.
Indio, man, ya kufika, maze. And yani, India, taught me that I need to harness an essence of being pleasant.
Mm.
Because I didn't know the frame of mind she was on when I met her that day.
Mm.
Maybe she was going through a bad day. Maybe she was having the worst day of her life.
Mm.
But she gave me attention. She gave me time. She followed through. And of all the artists I've worked with in the album, I think it was the easiest collab was that one.
So how? So what you were like, can we work on a song together?
She's like, fantastic, send the song. We recorded the song, every girl deserves to feel like a star.
Everything.
Sent it to her. After 2-3 weeks, we were told, she sent back her vocals, she's done. Then she sent her voice note saying, guys, that's my take on the song. If you feel like I should change anything, let me know, blah, blah, blah. So I start playing the song and I listen to it from my verse, from the beginning. When she came in, I felt like I was singing in a tin can, like her sonics.
Yeah.
Well, on another level, her microphone, her everything, yeah. Like any in the idea you took your song, you can feel like I'm a minimum plan, you are isn't like a poker kitambo, local layer, you know. Then we called her engineer and asked her, because now if we did the song the way it was, yeah, it would sound weird. Mm. Called her engineer, which microphone did you guys use? Told us the name of the mic. We bought the mic.
Okay.
We had a studio called Snowball Industries. They bought the mic there, the Snowball, for $10,000, bro.
What?
Yeah. They bought the mic. Then I recorded my verse. It still didn't reach India's, but it felt at least. Yeah, man. And working with her was, I don't know, man, that's a milestone for me. Just for me. I don't know, for the fans, for everybody in the band, but for me in particular.
Yep.
That's my heart.
And then the video. Now, how does the video happen?
The video didn't of happen course, the way because, it would have happened.
Exactly,
because of COVID.
Because of COVID.
I feel like we're still going to shoot a video. Oh. We've never met, but we talk all the time on, like, you know, Skype and all these Zooms and these things. But I think meeting Indiari and hanging out with her now, okay, properly. We've met, but now,
exactly,
you know, sitting down, having a drink. She really wants to come to Kenya, so I'm like thinking, yo, can bring her to Kenya, take her to Malindi, take her to Diani, Masai Mara, Apa Ivi. You know, Nairobi is beautiful.
Very.
Kenya is beautiful, so she'll really enjoy, I'm sure.
And for you, like, that must have been so huge. Do you ever flash back to the days you guys were in Uhuru Park and just be like, look at me now,
know,
with Indiari?
After I met Indiari that day, man, I after she sent her vocals and I heard the song, just before the album came out, I was listening to the album obsessively for a minute. Because, you know, like, as an artist, that's how it is.
That's what it is.
A lot before. Then when it's out, you don't listen anymore. But, man, I had moments when I just cried tears when I heard that song, because I was like, hey, this is what it is like when you dream and when you want something. It'll come to you when it comes to you, but you need to be working when it comes.
Every girl deserves to feel like a star. Good vibes and I'm grateful. Apa nita panda mbegu. You deserve to feel things you never felt before. Love you like I never did before. You don't know what's in store for you. Melanin and so much more. Heavy is your crown.
Heavy is your crown.
The way you hold me down.
Hold me down.
I hope I never let you down, my love. Every girl deserves to feel like a star. And I know you are.
I know you are.
I know you are. Every girl deserves to feel.
Every
like
girl
a star.
Deserves to feel like a star.
And I know you are. I know you are.
Ah, man, yeah. You need to, it will come to you
when it comes to you,
but you
need
to be
working when it comes.
Ah, you guys.
She didn't find you flat footed.
Let me tell you what I told you. So we're going to spend some time on this album because I really feel like the quality of this album is insane. From a production perspective, from a message perspective, Soba. Let's talk about Soba. For me, that song, I'm just like, you know, you're right, there are some songs guys listen to when they are solo, you get. I realize I'm not a lyrical person per se. This one I spent time with the lyrics.
What do you mean? But you're a rapper, man.
I know, it's very weird. But me, I like harmonies. Even, I mean, melodies.
Okay, so I'm
a rapper who doesn't listen to rappers.
Hey.
I literally boast, man, Mariah Carey, Bien.
You're soft.
Yeah, me, I'm soft. So anyway, let's go into this sober. Hey, that first of all, that message is really deep. I went even in the comments on YouTube.
And then also now the album Midnight Train, even like if I'm to speak about sober. I wrote Sober with my wife.
Mm-hmm.
Sober is about a personal relative to me of mine who was caught up in a heroin addiction and has never been able to recover. He lost him, man. Like, he became schizophrenic. And every time I went to see him in the mental institution he was at, he always gave me the plans, the big plans he had. Like, yo, you know, I'm going to leave this place. I'm going to call my daughter. You know, I'm going to like get a lorry, start a business, and look for my friends. I'm going to make amends, man, you know.
Yeah.
I'll stop drinking, you know, like, because every time I drink is when I like slip back. Like, he just has all of these ideas. And every time he gets out, he slips back, you know. But the song is about the plight of someone who wants to quit addiction. And yeah.
When I get sober, I'll get my act together. I will put my life in order. No longer be a victim of the devil on my shoulder. Lord knows I've been lost for way too long. I'm getting older. Now move down now, yo, yo, my sin. Call my mama and tell her that I'm sorry for the lies and pain I've caused her. And tell her that I never meant to turn out like my father. Lord knows that she cried too many tears for all my drama.
And it's touched a lot of gays' lives.
Yo, I finally, after Midnight Train now, I started feeling like I'm making music with purpose.
Whoa, that's deep.
Yeah, because you know, there's all the songs you can write, like Sautisol was making hits. But in Midnight Train, I found purpose. Even the songs, what they mean to me today, means something totally different to me a year later. When I listen to Midnight Train, it's talking to me a different language.
You get it.
Like, steady rocking on the midnight train. What it meant to me when I wrote it, I didn't even know what it meant when I was writing. Midnight Train came to me standing with Delvo outside his house at night, smoking a J. And hi maisha ni safari tunapita kama moshi na kabla tuzame mchangani kuna kushinda na kufeli. Oh, steady rocking on the midnight train. I don't even remember yani like how it came to me, but even when I was writing it, I didn't understand how prophetic it is to me. I'm not saying to everybody, like how it speaks to my
you.
Life.
Imaisha ni safari tunapita kama moshi na kabla tuzame mchangani kuna kushinda na kufeli. Oh, inabidi ujijue tofauti ya mwalimu na mwanafunzi ni ujuzi na ujuaji. Oh, it's unbelievable that we make it this far. Undeniable, we see the promised land from afar. And it's so beautiful, no they can't touch the fire. And you know it's not in vain, we're steady tripping through the pain. Oh, we're steady rocking on the midnight train. Steady rocking on the midnight train. On the midnight train, yeah, to Zion, Zion.
You know, even songs like Kako Sawa, Binko Sawa mean something totally different to me now. You know, like when they're out, I'm like, hey, so this song pain is angalio na perspective na mean heavy.
Bado wose manga mine psycho, bado mupiganga simu yako.
Nilidelete ngi namba yako lakini naikumbuka anga kwa moyo yo. And I just can't explain thoughts of you and me keep going up and down in my brain. And you were looking for some love, didn't care for the fame. I was looking for a good time playing the game, yeah. And now you're stuck on my lane. Moving in together, baby, it was never the same. Oh, it's such a shame. Kila saa tunakumbana. Lini tutaelewana?
Tulichaja kuja tumalize kinachokwaza. Baby, siandike. Punguza drama.
I don't wanna argue, kanko sawa, minko sawa. Kanko sawa, minko sawa. Aki zile vitu tulipanga. Ukanishukisha namba. Najona misi hiki tanda.
So then that's the element I was in when I was writing Midnight Train. And it's so crazy to see that those songs, I'm not gonna get old ever.
They're not. I think they're timeless songs. Susanna. Oh, Susanna. Yeah. Explain that. That was the first.
I wrote Susanna with Mviri. And then we were like having a drink up. And me and Mviri just have these nights when we just have a drink up and we're writing throughout the whole time fun songs. So I had, Polycarp had made the riff. And then Mviri was there, we were writing. And then we were like, ah, wacha tukachukue simu sasa to record. And when we went to get our phones to record, we had forgotten everything we had written. The whole, like, there's a first verse and a chorus.
Yeah.
So what you're hearing now of Susanna is a new, like, verse, chorus, everything. Tulisa how? Umesa how? Hey, uko serious? Uko na record mali kwa simu zi? Umesa how your verse kabisa? Nelikuwa verse moja stereo. Tukaanza tu, oh Susanna, afresh, na kuona Paris.
But it still came out well.
Lakini bado ikakuwa, hey, ina energy flani na hiyo storytelling. Na Susanna pia unajua mimi grew up, mimi mluya, waluya wengi wamegrow up wakisikiza Tabule, Rochero, Franco. Hizo ndo mamziki zenye budangu wakucheza kwa hao. So like, Susanna really speaks to that time of my life when I used to listen to Franco. Or my dad used to play rumba music the whole Sunday afternoon. Or yep. Traveling to Shags. And my dad has that one rumba tape that plays the whole trip.
Is that what informed the video?
100%, yeah, it did. Like the whole album Midnight Train is built to create nostalgia. Like to remind you of moments of your, to remind our generation of moments of our upbringing. You know, like you see Susanna, you can see familiarity from the past.
Yep.
It's the future nostalgia, basically.
Yeah, actually, it's like, bringing the nostalgia that you had and making a generation that may not be feel nostalgia have
the nostalgia and understand. And then, you know, like 20 years from now, also there's a kid who's gonna be looking at Susanna like it was the moment, but they won't understand that was
the moment. Yeah, the moment.
The music is, that's what music does. The music is a futuristic, you know.
Oh Susanna, I hope you're happy now. I see you flexing on the ground with your sponsor, Susanna. I hope you're happy now. I see you change your skin color and your hair is longer now. Na kuona Paris hapo kando ya Champs-Élysées. Ukitesa na kamini, none of my business. And I see you in London, silicone on your mama, shaking what your doctor gave ya. On your worst behavior, Susanna Van
Zandt.
Oh no, no.
I love it.
Yeah.
So again, still in this album, the jam you guys did with the South Africans, the choir. So
it was the choir, Brighter Days.
Yeah. And the first single you dropped off from this album.
It was the first single was Susanna.
Okay.
So it was the choir was second. It wasn't meant to be the second release, but because of COVID, we just thought the message really speaks to the moment.
Okay.
Then we released that song. Yeah.
How was it?
So it's a gospel choir. Yeah. Pleasant human beings, man. We
did and the even song. Them, they have some heritage.
Send
to them.
They have 3 Grammys. They kept on like telling us, "You people don't have Grammys, eh? Shut up!" Like, you know, like any just artist
yeah,
jokes.
Yeah, my jokes. Yeah.
Yeah, like, hey, Grammy Award winning Soweto Gospel 3 times. Like, they just have a very good energy yeah. about them. They are beautiful people. They came to the video shoot. The video shoot took like 2 hours. It was done.
Yeah.
They recorded their parts in record time. And record angelic nature, like that whole song. Me, I think Brecha Days is one of the songs in the album that'll never die.
Cause I'm certain brighter days are yet to come. Ain't no question that tomorrow there'll be good times.
You know, we were having this conversation with you about some songs pop. They shoot up quickly, but then yeah, on the album, songs, these albums are helicopter. They like, well, in fact, give them the analogy. Yeah, tell them what you were telling
there's
me.
There's a helicopter analogy and there's a plane analogy. Uh-huh. Helicopter takes off like this and comes down like this.
Mm.
So like the big songs in the album, the Susannas, are always going to pick up fast. But you know, there's just a song there that's a sleeper, like Nenda Lote Mama.
That one is so huge.
And even if you look at the streams, other songs have gone up and gone down. It's just it's just consistently growing. So it's a plane. It's just taking off like this, and it's going to be going higher and higher and higher.
Yeah.
And
like, can we talk about that song? Because